So variables, what is a variable, guys? So like in, let's talk about in your kitchen, right? There are different jars. In one, you have stored salt. In one, you have stored sugar. In one, you have stored tea. In one, you have stored something else. And they all look similar. How are you gonna identify in which one we have stored in salt, and in which one we have stored sugar, in which one we have stored something else? It's just gonna add a name tag, right? That in this jar we have stored sugar, in this jar we have stored salt. So we just add a name onto it. That's exactly how we do it in programming languages as well. Whenever we want to store anything, what we do is we create a variable which basically stores a particular information, right? So if you want to store a percentage, we're going to create a variable which is like percentage or percent or something like that, and which is going to store a particular information. And later on that program, we can refer to that name and that value will come automatically, right? So let's say if this is percent, this is amount. So we store the information in our programs in order, and later we can use those in later we can use those names in order to get the value of it. So in percent, I have stored 78. In amount, I have stored 1000. So if later in my program, I'm going to write down percent, what value is going to come, give it to me? 78. If I'm going to write down amount, 1000. That's it. That's how easy it is. And as the name suggests, or as the name states, variable, that means it can be changed, right? A variable's information, or the information that we are storing into a variable, can be changed. So in amount, I can make it up as 2000. And after making it as 2000, whenever I'll use the amount, what value I'm going to get? 2000. That's exactly what it is. I hope it makes sense. Everyone? Okay. So that's exactly what variables are. A variable is a named value holder in memory, which stores a... which refers to a particular memory location in which we store a particular information, and we can change that information. Okay, now this complete is a variable, and this is what we call as an identifier, right? The name that we allocate to a variable is called as an identifier, and there are certain rules in order to give a name to an identifier. Let's see what they are. The name we choose for a variable is called an identifier. An identifier can be of any length in Apex. So by the way, the rules to name a variable, or the rules to label an identifier or to name an identifier are different in different programming languages. In C it is different, in Java it is different, in Apex is different, right? So I'm specifying those rules to you. Operators and spaces are not allowed. So I cannot have amount percentage 100. I cannot have name like that. I cannot have amount or AMT space. I cannot have a name as total amount, total space amount. No, I cannot have spaces in the variable names. That's what it is. Operators and spaces are not allowed. We cannot use any Apex reserved keywords when naming variables. So what are keywords? Exactly. So there are predefined words that have already got a meaning in Apex programming language. In Apex programming language, like public, void, static, and class, and integer. Something like that. No, there is no constant. All of these things are predefined names that we have given to it, right? So these predefined names can't be used as an identifier for a particular variable. We cannot have an integer named as public. Integer public is equals to 50. We cannot have that. So that's what it is. I think you all are aware of it, I guess. Next, keywords are the words that are essential for an Apex language. Integer i_a, it is allowed? Yes, it is allowed. Integer underscore ia, not allowed. Why? So this is not allowed, right? because it cannot start with a with an underscore, right? With an yeah, with an underscore. Underscore can be there in between, but it cannot start with an underscore. In the last, also there cannot be any underscore. And I mean, integer I2, there can there be a number in an in a variable? There can be, but it cannot. It should not start with a number, right? It cannot be 2i. It can be i2, right? So this is correct. And then I space, no space is allowed. Dollar. So dollar is allowed in some of the programming languages, by the way. In Java, I think it is allowed. You can use dollar, and you can start a variable named by dollar as well. But in Apex, it is not allowed. Then comes dollar i2. Yeah, no, not allowed. Dollar underscore i2, no, not allowed. That's what it is. Let me give you another, some other... Is it allowed? It is allowed, right? There's no problem with this. So yeah, I mean, just figure out what works as an identifier and just label it. And there are some rules that I want to state in here. And by the way, I'm not only going to teach you Salesforce development, I'm not only going to teach you Apex, but I'm also going to teach you the right coding practices that you guys have to follow in order to be a better developer overall, right? That's what is important. Anyone can do the work, but we need people who can do the work in the right way, right? And that's what we are focused on. So listen to me, your variable name should not be like IJK. These were the names that we used to use while we were working on two patterns and everything, where the name had no influence onto the program that we created. Listen to this very carefully, that what coding practices you guys have to follow. All the variable names should be meaningful. It should be in camel notation or the underscore notation. I do not know what to call that underscore notation because I use camel notation. Anyone of amongst you who doesn't know camel notation? What is camel notation? No, that's not that. Okay. So if you want to write down total amount, so there are two ways of writing down total amount, right? So it's like when I'm going to pronounce it, it's going to sound like total amount, right? But if I'll just make a change, a little change, so camel has got that hump, right? So whenever there is a different word that you're attaching to that name, make sure to make the make that letter as capital and rest all small, and then again capital. So if it says tax per user, so in that case you have to write it down like this. Right? Tax per user. So it's easier. Otherwise, it would have sounded like tax per user, right? So that's the reason you have to use camel notation, or you can use tax per user. So all of these two, like these two is underscores. You can use that while declaring it. And all the variable names should have a meaning. And whatever value they're storing, it should denote to that. Like if you're storing amount, do not just leave it as AMT. You might understand what is AMT, but the one who is who has not created this code, it should not only be understandable to you, it should be understandable to whosoever person who is reading that code or who's working onto that code. Because if you are passionate enough about your career, you're soon going to leave that project and work onto another project. And there's going to be someone who's going to take care of your project. And that someone should not curse you. And in order for them not to curse you, you should make the code or write the code in such a way that it is easily understandable and consumable and digestible to the people who are reading that. It is very important. If you're writing a complex code, just make sure to write the comment over there. Right? We all understand what is a comment. Right? What is it? So in a code, we write down comments, double slash, and then we describe it. That what exactly we have written down over here. So while declaring the methods, make sure to comment like what this method is used for and why we have created this method. While declaring variables, if the name in itself is not defining what it is, then write down the comment for it. Otherwise, if the name is sufficient, then do not write the comment over it. If you're writing a complex logic, make sure to, like, if, okay, let's say if there are 500 lines in your method, then in that case, divide it into parts and describe what this part is doing, what this part is doing, what this part is doing, what this part is doing. So even if the person is not haven't got the time to read that complete code, they'll just read the comments and will understand what exactly you're doing in here, what exactly you're doing in here, what exactly you're doing in here, and is it exactly what they want. So you always have to write down the comments, and you always have to declare the variable names and everything in the right way. That's following the right coding practice, and it is very, 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 very important. If there are two developers, let me tell you my situation. If there are two developers, one is good and another one is average. That good person is not willing to write down the code according to the code best right coding practices. Includes comments, includes writing the right variable names, includes not using recursive programs, and many other things are there. And the average person is willing to, use the right coding practices. I'm going to remove that good guy and I'm going to give the work to that average guy. Because it's not about how good of a programmer you are, but it's more about how good of a code that you write. Is it what do you know about indentation? Proper formatting, right? So there is a class. So if you'll see my code, not a single class is unformatted. I can write it down like this as well. It's going to have the same meaning, by the way. So some people write the code like this. I'm telling you, I can fire these people like anything. If I find a program like this, I'm going to fire that person. There are five lines in here. And these five lines, in these five lines only, I'm not able to understand where the block starts and where the block ends. Imagine if I've got a 500 line code or a 1,000 line code. What is going to happen at that moment? Right? Many of the times they have missed a semicolon. Like, let's say. Many of the times they have missed a semicolon. How am I going to get to know that there's a semicolon missing in here? If there's the compiler is not working, or there are multiple problems that can happen. So the code should be properly indented and formatted. That's again another right coding practice that you guys have to follow. Right? Without indentation, please do not write the code, because it becomes a mess for the other person who's trying to understand that code. And there's going to be situations in which the other people are trying to understand your code, like code reviews, maintenance, and other stuff. So make sure that you're following the right coding practices. It should not be understandable only to you. It should be understandable or digestible to the people who all are part of it or who are going to be a part of it. So that's what it is. Let's move back. Apex constants. So what is a constant? Let's talk about that. So if you declare a variable in here, by the way, how to declare a variable? Integer i12, right? System.debug I is equals to 17. Right? So this is a program that I've written, and I'm going to execute this program. So the value which is stored inside I is getting changed again and again. That's exactly what a variable does, right? But what I want is I want to make it constant. That means once a value is defined for that particular variable, it should not be changed later in the program at all. So what I'm going to add over here is, now once the value is defined, by the way, this complete is called as declaration. This is called as definition or assigning a particular value. And this is called as declaration as well as defining, right? So if I'm going to make it final, that means later in the program, this value cannot be changed. So see, this class will get saved. And when we'll execute this, final exception. final variable has already been initialized. So once a value has been initialized for a final variable, it cannot be modified, which we are trying to do over here. It will give an exception. So we are making a particular value, a particular variable's value constant. That's how we do that with the help of final keyword. Yeah, that's what it is. So now this will work. It's working fine now. There's no final exception. Well, that's it. Right? Okay. One more thing. Will this work? Okay. So it will work, right? It will definitely work. The reason is the value of a constant or the value of a key variable, which is final, can only be initialized once while declaring it or after declaring it. Can only be initialized once, not more than once. So if you have not declared it over here or if you have not initialized it over here, you can initialize the value later on. But after initializing, you cannot edit it or modify it. Let's see. Worked? No final exception? Hey man, 15. Right? That's how it goes. That's how it goes with constants. Is it clear? Now let's talk about literals. So while we were writing this particular program, this is a literal. A simple value that you assign to a variable is called as a literal. So in integer's case, integer I is equals to 15, 15 is literal. If there is a string, S is equals to Shrey, and in that case, Shrey is a literal. That's it. Okay. And then comes expression. Expression is basically this. This is an expression, right? And this is a constant expression. And this one is a variable expression, right? Constant expression basically means that all the values which are there in that expression are constants. Not that constant, like final one, but are literals. And when it comes to an expression which includes some variables, like I is there in this one, this is called as a variable expression. That's it.